To introduce the talk today, which is called Resistance Through Poetry in Pakistan, Tradition and Personal Journey. Our speaker today is Haris Khaliq, who is a leading poet and a secretary, also the Secretary General of the Human Rights Commission of Pakistan. And he writes in several languages himself, in Urdu and English, and has 9 collections of verse, 2 books of nonfiction, and several hundred articles and newspaper columns on diverse topics, including international development, human rights, history, culture, and literature. He is a recipient of the Presidential Pride of Performance Award and the UBL Literary Excellence Award in Pakistan, and was also a University of Iowa Honorary Fellow in writing. His work has been widely translated and anthologized internationally. And just one word about the image on the screen that you see is actually the poet Habib Jalib, who is reciting his verse in protest at a meeting, public meeting organized by feminist organizations in 1983 against some of the anti-feminist laws that were that the regime of General Ziaul-Haq was promulgating. So Jalib was an important resistance poet in the history of Urdu poetry. So without further ado, I hand over the microphone to Haris.
Thank you very much. I mean, it is a privilege to be able to speak at the South Asia program of Cornell. I wish I were in Ithaca, but once the pandemic subsides, I would certainly come and see you there. And I'm very happy to see Kamran as they're really in the middle of the participants. hello, Kamran. Assalamu alaikum. I hope you're well. And thank you very much, everyone who's found time to be here. Morning for you and evening for me. It is something really close to my heart. When Professor Dadi asked me to speak on the subject, I felt really privileged, as I said. And I think I've got 30 to 40 minutes, Daniel.
Yeah, that's correct. Yeah.
Right. Okay. Yeah. So what I'm going to do, I mean, it's of course a very long history, and it is more. Perhaps when you listen to me, perhaps it is far more nuanced than I would be able to put it. And it is much more, it is more complicated. And it is not going to be an exhaustive sort of a lecture, as it were, because I'm a poet myself and not an academic. And even academics can't be exhaustive all the time. Maybe I miss some names, but I will try to basically look at the last almost 300 years of Urdu resistance poetry through resistance, resistance through poetry, resistance to power. And I would like to begin by saying that art has a very difficult relationship with power and all forms of art. In the former Soviet Union, perhaps it was the music composers who were seen as resisting power, and they were regulated. Shostakovich, for instance, and other art forms like caricatures, from caricatures to abstract art. I mean, there's a whole range. But in our tradition, particularly in India and Pakistan. And more so in, if I may be allowed to use the term liberally, the Indo-Muslim culture, so to speak, poetry is the main form of art that we have nurtured, we have experienced, and we have used to counter or to challenge power. And so there is a kind of a triangle between art and politics and power, because you see that people I'm going to speak about have participated in politics, but their participation in politics using their art as a tool was to challenge power. I mean, that is the tradition. And I wish to begin it with Jafar Zatalli, because Jafar Zatalli is someone who's very, who's unsung, even now, even after being recognized as the pioneer resistance poet in Urdu literature. He hasn't gained that recognition that he deserves, even after being known, rather, not recognized. And Jafar Zatalli used to ridicule power, and he is, you know, before him and even after him, his contemporaries, before and after, and his contemporaries, the basic themes in literature, in Urdu poetry, were existential, romantic, and descriptive. So if I give you names, I mean, that wouldn't make a lot of sense for some of our, non-South Asian friends who are participating, but it may, because some of you must be, you know, reading about these things also. So one of our most important descriptive poets from that period is Nazir Akbar Abadi, who is an amazing poet, but he's very descriptive. I mean, he writes about festivals. He's a people's poet, undoubtedly, but he's not a resistance poet. He writes about people's festivals. He writes about people's lives. He writes about communal harmony in the then Indian subcontinent, and when British had arrived but had not completely taken over. So then Mir Taqi Mir, who's our giant, the most important poet of the 18th century, late 17th and early 18th century. Mir Taqi Mir was more of an existential poet. I mean, there's a lot of political commentary in his verse as well, but that political commentary is from an individual's lens. I mean, it is how he sees his city being destroyed, or how he sees his migration from his birth or his native place to another place in India, and how he experiences the anguish and the suffering. So it is not from a communal or a community lens or a social lens, but it is more from his personal lens. So it is very important poetry, but I would rather not call it resistance poetry. Then we have Ghalib, Mirza Asadullah Khan Ghalib, who comes after Jafar Zatalli, of course, but Ghalib is also both a romantic and an existential poet. He also has political commentary, but it actually is not about other people, except for a few verses here and there. More about the artist and the artist's relationship with universe, or the art, or with cosmos, and artist's relationship with people who live around him or her. So that is how it worked. And Jafar Zatalli started ridiculing power, and he would use lampoonery, and he would disregard and discredit people in power by using expletives liberally in his verse. He was an equally good poet in Persian and in Urdu, but in Urdu, he is seen as not just as the first resistance poet, but he was also killed or martyred, so to speak, by King Farrukhsiyar, a later Mughal king, in 1713. So that is how it begins. And Jafar's work is available in the US also, because interestingly, it was first published after a long, long time. It was first compiled and published by Dr. Rashid Hassan Khan, but the first, it was published in the US first, and then it was made available, and then, so of course, republished in India and Pakistan. So Jafar Zatalli, I think, is somebody who is important, because he was absolutely brave, and the kind of idiom and as I said, expletives, but also the idiom that he has used to ridicule power and writing these long poems against naming people in his poems, and against the governors or against the rulers of the city or the state. So he lost his life. He was killed by the king. So he dies in 1713. After that, what we see is in the mid late 18th century, 1713 is 18th century, and early 19th century, we see that the British gain further strength in India, and actually they establish, East India Company has established its roots all over and virtually running the country, even if the nominal Mughal king was still in power in Delhi. But what we see happening again in that period is largely romantic poetry, or poetry, even if it is political, with personal overtones. So there is a sort of a gap, I mean, in terms of, you know, what we define as resistance poetry now. And then, you know, in the late 1800s, which is the late 19th century, under the influence of Sir Syed Ahmad Khan, who was a reformer and who was a sort of a modernist in terms of, introducing modern disciplines of education, as well as scientific education, and introducing Indian Muslims to the education in English and off English, we see another literary movement grow. But that literary movement introduces modern themes, modern vocabulary, or contemporary in those times. I mean, modern has a different meaning when we speak about modernism in literature, but when I say modern, I mean Nai, Jadid, which was, you know, contemporary in those times, and ideas and analyses or categories of analyses for judging or canonizing poetry being borrowed from the West, from the British. So they introduce a literary movement, but that is modern but compliant. So it is important to understand that in the 19th century, largely we do not see any major resistance poets emerging in Urdu, or Urdu, Hindi, Hindustani, as we can put it. But the turning point is in the late 19th century, Josh Maliabadi is born, and Maulana Hasrat Mohani is also born. Now, these two people precedes the Progressive Writers Association when it comes to writing clear-cut anti-imperial, anti-colonial, and pro-people socialist poetry. So Josh Maliabadi is already an established poet when the Progressive Writers Association in India established in 1936 under the influence of the global communist movement. Now, Josh Maliabadi and Hasrat Mohani are established resistance poets in early 20th century and the first half of the 20th century before the Progressive Writers Movement emerged. But their poetry is, essentially anti-colonial in nature. And as I said, they are influenced, although Maulana Hasrat Mohani was a very pious, religious man, but there is a tradition of, some of our, he was not a cleric, but he was a practicing Muslim, but he was secular, of course, and greatly influenced by the 1917 revolution in the Soviet Union. So these two people, Josh Maliabadi and Hasrat Mohani, reintroduce the tradition of resistance in Urdu verse, like Jafar Zatalli in some sense, not entirely. I mean, they are perhaps, if you look at the literary merit, they are ahead of Jafar Zatalli in terms of their treatment of themes and the aesthetics that they employ, but the poeticity of their verse, but they actually have to be recognized and seen in that perspective. Dr. Allama Muhammad Iqbal, whatever you wish to call him, he was the, I mean, to me, to poets in terms of poetry and craft and metaphor, he's considered the greatest Urdu language poet and also Persian language poet in the 20th century. Iqbal also resisted against and wrote against kinds of exploitation that were happening in South Asia. But essentially, he's a civilizational poet, and he speaks about, he has different concerns. He has influenced even the progressive writers and any poet that came after him, because he was so large. but he is not necessarily, I mean, he's not a resistance poet. He has influenced resistance poetry, but he's not a resistance poet. So it is Josh Maliabadi and Maulana Asaf Wani. Now, after that, the progressive writers movement begins in South Asia and in progressive in India, and progressive writers movement actually created that framework and that space for resistance poetry to establish itself as a proper recognized genre. And that happens in the as I said, that Hasrat Mohani and Josh Maliabadi, by virtue of being established resistance poets, of course, became a part of the progressive writers movement. And it also took an institutional shape in terms of the Progressive Writers Association. And there's a lot of work, a body of work available on that now. So I'm not going to get into the details of that. But the progressive writers movement produced most cherished voices in Urdu, for instance, Faiz Ahmed Faiz, Ali Sardar Jafri, Kefi Azmi, and there are so many, many others. It was a galaxy of poets and prose writers, particularly short story writers and poets who are a product of the Progressive Writers Movement. Now, the Progressive Writers Movement and the association, which was the institutional face of the movement, they were anti-colonial, and of course they had very obvious socialist agenda. They wanted India to be liberated, and they wanted India or the Indian subcontinent as we speak to have a left-wing socialist dispensation politically and economically. So there was the poets, actually, some of the poets who we, in retrospect, when we look at them, they had, more humanistic concerns than socialist scientific, concerns of scientific socialism. So they saw socialism as a way to uplift the people living in abject poverty around them, to ensure labor rights in the newly emerging industries in South Asia, to ensure farmers' rights. So they perhaps may not have believed that much, and they had known very little about the Stalinist Soviet Union or the kind of political oppression the impossibility of dissent in some of the socialist countries during their times. But they had this thinking, and they were not apologetic about it. They wanted socialist revolutions in these countries, but their concerns were driven by the poverty and inequality that they saw around them. But the most important of these voices are those which did not compromise on aesthetics and did not actually buckle under the pressure of social realism, which was professed and promoted by the communist parties in many countries at that time, including the Communist Party of India and a couple of factions that emerged out of the Communist Party of India. So the Progressive Writers Association, after that, fast forward, I come not really that fast forward, because 11 years after the association was established, Pakistan came into being. Partition of British India happened, and after Pakistan, because that is something which is the chief concern for this conversation, we see that there is a combination, and I find it very interesting because it is completely the other way around in Central Eastern Europe, where I have some experience of working with Amnesty International in those countries, where the whole human rights and democracy agenda emerged from the right-wing resistance. In our case, in case of South Asia, and like in many other developing countries, it's completely the other way around. The idea of human freedoms, human rights, and democracy have emerged from the left, because we were under right-wing dictatorships and right-wing conservative rules and extreme forms of exploitation under colonialism and the kind of capitalism that we inherited. So it is very interesting that after Pakistan comes into being, the poets who are a part of the Progressive Writers Association, or the poets who are not even a part of the Progressive Writers Association because it was banned in the early years, but then it started, there were other shapes and forms that writers associations or cultural organizations took in Pakistan, staying with their sort of left-wing inclinations. So they, interestingly, they had three fundamental concerns, the resistance poets, and they continuously challenged, because their expression resonated with people. Because I haven't spoken about it, actually I hinted at that, but the importance of poetry in our social discourse and in our political discourse and in our living room conversations is incomparable to most other traditions, if not all. I mean, there are some other traditions also one is familiar with, but in most other traditions, poetry does not enjoy that sort of primary importance in any kind of human expression that it does in our cultures. So they use their verse, even if not writing in their poetry, but when they become important as poets, what they say publicly as sort of public intellectuals, that also becomes important. So their writings, even if not in verse, but also in their verse, their concerns were essentially democracy, socialism, and peace in South Asia. So this is something really interesting, that resistance poets in Pakistan actually have always pushed for a peaceful settlement of issues between India and Pakistan. And they have been branded traitors, and they have been put into prisons, and they have been censored, because they are considered pro-India, so to speak. And because they wanted, they were not pro or anti-India. I mean, because, there's a lot to actually challenge the Indian narrative as well. But they wanted peace in South Asia, and they thought that the premise of partition in 1947 was to bring peace between those provinces of British India where Muslims were in majority, and those provinces in Muslim India where Hindus were in a majority. So they actually, from Ustad Daman in Punjabi, Faiz Ahmed Faiz in Urdu, to Habib Jalib in Urdu, to Fehmida Riaz in Urdu, and I'll come to the feminist poetry as well after that. But their concerns was democracy, socialism, and peace. And why democracy? Because Pakistan came under military influence. Pakistan was a frontline state in the Cold War, as you would know, and the US government at the time was supportive of right-wing military dictatorships across the developing world, and Pakistan was a frontline state. And Pakistan, the military, which we have inherited, I mean, we have inherited all our permanent institutions from the colonial times, the military, the judiciary, and the bureaucracy, but military is the, is armed, and the rest are not. So it becomes the most, the strongest institution anyway. So the military is supported by international powers, the Western powers, and the military becomes the most dominant political force in 1955. With support from our Western allies. And in 1958, the military takes over the newly born country, and martial law is imposed in 1958. Now, it will be very interesting to note, and I'm very happy that on the screen, what Professor Dadi displayed the picture that is of Habib Jalib, because General Ayub Khan, who was a self-proclaimed field marshal, without perhaps winning any battles, he was the person he dreaded the most. And there is a lot of writing available to us and accounts available to us, was Habib Jalib. And because of his poem that had become an anthem, where he rejected the 1962 martial, you know, the constitution promulgated by the general, you know, in 1962, he promulgated a new constitution, because the 1956 constitution, which the Constituent Assembly of had promulgated, was 1956 constitution was abrogated, and a new constitution in 1962 was put in place. So Habib Jalib wrote a scathing poem, and it is so lyrical, and it became an anthem of resistance against the new constitution under the martial regime. And it is called constitution. The word for that in Urdu is both dastoor and ayin, and it is called dastoor, which means constitution. And he completely refuses to accept anything that the constitution says. And he, in that poem, as a dastoor ko subh benoor ko main nahi janta main nahi manta. It's a, you know, it has a few stanzas, five or six stanzas, and it became the unifying slogan for all the political resistance in Pakistan, and across linguistic ethnic divides and across party divides. And so that was the power and the force that poetry displayed. Habib Jalib is And poets in our country, I mean, poets have served prisons, poets have served, have faced censorship. So he was censored, he was sent to prison, and a lot of suffering was inflicted on Jalib and other poets who were like him. But Jalib certainly symbolizes that resistance against Ayub Khan. And he wrote many other poems. And many other ghazals and nazms both, which are two dominant or the most popular forms or genres that we have in Urdu verse. After Habib Jalib, we also see in the 70s, when Zulfiqar Ali Bhutto comes to power, which was a kind of a democracy gets restored. East Pakistan has seceded, or Bangladesh is liberated, and a new country is born. So what we are left with is Pakistan, the West Pakistan, what we now call Pakistan. And in the even in the 1960s, it had begun. But in the 1960s and the 1970s, another movement of resistance in poetry that we witness is feminist poetry in Urdu. Urdu, there was Malaka Bai Chanda 200, 300 years ago, in Hyderabad, Dakkan in South India, who was writing Urdu verse. She's perhaps considered the first woman to have a collection, a diwan to her name published. But there's been a tradition of women writing, and there were some very good poets who emerged in the late 19th and early 20th century among women. But among women poets, this very strong feminist voice comes out in the 60s and the 70s. And Fehmida Riaz is the most important poet in my view, who is among the best poets that we have produced in the last many decades. And she's not just a feminist poet. I mean, she's, but you know, feminism is a very strong sentiment, and she has articulated, and expressed the woman's voice as no one else in Urdu. But she was preceded by an equally important Kishwar Naheed. So Kishwar Naheed and Fehmida Riaz are, before that, as I said, that women, like I spoke about resistance poetry, political poetry, that, you know, people work making political comments, but it was not a social comment. It was their personal take on politics. Likewise, women before them, like Zahra Nigar and Adha Jafri, and quite a few others, they were writing on women's issues. Parveen Shakir came after them. I mean, they were highlighting their personal anxieties and living in an oppressive patriarchal society. But to give the woman, the downtrodden and the oppressed and exploited woman a voice, which any woman could relate to, which is not just an affluent middle class woman, but any woman could relate to that. It was basically Kishwa Naid and Fehmida Riaz. And since then, and Fehmida died just a few years ago, and Kishwa Naid is still alive and writing. So you can see that, you know, in the last 50, 60 years, Pakistan's feminist writers and or the feminist poets who have been writing on, you know, everything under the sun otherwise as well. But there is a certain strong voice that they have given to the voiceless and the invisible women of Pakistan. And this is very interesting that, you know, if you compare what is being written in India, there's a lot of good that is coming out of India, but their main language of expression, Urdu is not the only or the main language of expression when it comes to women's writing or when it comes to any writing for that matter. So you see this sort of a focus with Iqbal and Faiz and after Iqbal and Faiz shifting of creative writing, not the focus, but sort of the center of creative writing shifting from what is now India to what is now Pakistan when it comes to the most important Urdu writers that we have produced in the later half of the 20th century and in the last two decades of the 21st century. Although the criticism and of course, I mean, I'm not trying to undermine the writing and some very important, and there's a definite merit, there's a definite quality to a lot of writing that is coming out of India. But in Pakistan, this is the main language of public discourse and arts. So I think, you know, in that sense, most of the strongest of voices that have come out in literature are from what is now Pakistan. Then if you look at the other languages, because I think I've got 5 to 10 minutes left. So if you look at other languages, and then I'll come to my personal understanding of how I look at it. Other languages, you see, Urdu has a very, I would say a controversial role that Urdu has played when it comes to Pakistani politics. Urdu is a divider when it comes to matters of politics. But Urdu is a unifier when it comes to matters of art, when it comes to matters of literature, and when it comes to poetry. Because Habib Jalib and Faiz Ahmad Faiz and Fehmida Riaz are revered in places where people have a problem in smaller provinces in Pakistan, or even in Punjab, where there is a Punjabi language rights movement which was oppressed for a very long time, but it is re-emerging. So you find that Urdu has a difficult relationship with the other national languages that we speak or other languages that Pakistanis speak, because of the imposition of Urdu as a unifying language. And that's a completely different debate, and we don't have time for that. But there is a strong resistance to Urdu being used as the, or being seen as the sole representative language for everyone in the political sphere. But when it comes to literature, I think it is where Urdu actually has given a voice to any collective democratizing movements or the federalism, you know, the movement for federalism and decentralization and more power to the people. So Urdu poets have given a voice to everyone. But if you look at other languages, it is absolutely, amazing that the poets of the same caliber, and it is very unfortunate that they are not recognized because their languages are not, did not have any official patronage for a very long time. That Sheikh Ayaz, for instance, in Sindhi, or Gulkhan Nasir in Balochi, Ghani Khan in Pashto, Ustad Daman in Punjabi, and there's so many others. I mean, I can't, you know, as I said at the outset, that I will not be able to give an exhaustive list, and that is perhaps not the idea also. I mean, it's just to look at the trends. The way they have challenged oppression, martial regimes, whether it is from General Ayub Khan to General Pervez Musharraf, or even now when there is a sort of a hybrid regime in Pakistan, the way people are actually, giving voice to people through their verse and producing excellent poetry. I mean, it is not slogans. I mean, these people I'm naming, they are not sloganeers, or they are not lyricists, or I mean, there's nothing wrong in being a good lyricist also, but you know what I mean. I mean, there's some serious serious poetry that is coming out in all these languages. And there are so many women in particularly in, actually everywhere. I mean, but there is a stronger tradition in Sindh because Sindhi is a language which is more used than any other languages after Urdu in Pakistan, but also in Pashto, in the northern areas, the Gilgit-Baltistan in Pakistan. I mean, you will find both, resistance poets, which are absolutely amazing. And some of these poets are bilingual poets. So they choose to write in their mother tongues or their first language, as well as in Urdu. So it's a very strong tradition that continues. Of course, you can't have, poets who transcend centuries that often. But I think if the tradition continues, I'm not mayus. What is mayus?
Heartened. Disheartened.
I'm not disheartened. Yes, I'm not disappointed or disheartened or do not see this tradition of resistance in Urdu verse or resistance in other Pakistani languages and the verse coming out that we see, the feminist verse, the pro-people verse, challenging power, challenging hegemonic designs of whether the transnationals or their own governments. So this is what you see continuing to happen in Pakistan. And very quickly, one more minute, Professor Dadi, if you allow me, that, my personal journey has been a very sort of, I've been influenced by not just the progressive writers, interestingly, and not just the, the feminist writers who I think are very close to my heart. But you see, something that we haven't spoken about is there is a very, a rich tradition of existential poetry, of rhapsodic poetry, of absurdity in Urdu. So I think for a poet for a writer, for an artist, I think every piece of art has to be aesthetically pleasing and has to have depth first and foremost. So I think a new kind of writing that is emerging in Pakistan, which you can bracket under sort of resistance writing or progressive writing, as we call it traditionally, is kind of more broad and absorbs other influences as well, and absurdities as well, and the anxieties and the suffering sufferings which are totally personal. The inner voice needs to be heard as well. So I think that is where this tradition is heading. Thank you very much. I think I just finished in 40 minutes.
Well, thank you. I think there are, it's a group that we can have questions also and comments. So I welcome the audience to post questions or comments directly to Haris, if you would like. So Haris, while people are gathering their thoughts, I wanted to ask you, how do you think of your own verse? I mean, it's very hard to speak about yourself, I understand, but how would you situate your own position as a poet in this lineage that you've sketched for us?
You see, it's really very, it's difficult, but it's not that difficult to understand that it's such a rich history that, I take pride in being a part of that, to be in that company, and that's all. So it's actually there. People have done such amazing work, and it is so unfortunate that because we do not speak a European language as our first language or Arabic as our first language, a lot of it hasn't been translated. I mean, I totally understand that you need a Stephen Spender to translate Goethe, but it could have been translated. Much more could have been translated. So there are major, poets that we have in the present and we had in the past. So I'm one of them, and I think I'm just contributing my bit. But I see myself as a poet who has these very strong strands of resistance, but that is not the only theme. But I do comment. I mean, it is political. I do write political poetry, and I do write. I would see myself as one of the resistance poets, but I also write a lot about people who are otherwise invisible to the powers that be. I mean, I've written character poems in Urdu. I mean, if I speak about Urdu in English, some of my writing is actually very different from the traditional Anglophone Pakistani writing. And I think it is influenced by the works that I've read in Urdu. And other languages, of course, from, you know, in translation, perhaps more in most cases, but from Spanish and Polish to Arabic. So these modern trends and new forms of expression, and it's a different sensibility. I mean, it's a different, we are in different times we live. So I think I'm just sort of doing my bit, contributing to the sort of a larger tradition, and trying to introduce. In contemporary language, sometimes because there's a huge baggage that we carry because of the riveting classical poetry that we have. To shed that baggage, it is not always easy. I get that opportunity more in English because English is more of an acquired language. Even if I'm learning it from a small age, but it is. The sensibility is if not an alien, but a different sensibility. So in English, you find it easier to shed that baggage, which you can't in Urdu. So, I would rather say that poetry is my language, and Urdu, English, and a bit of Punjabi or an understanding of Sindhi and Farsi, they are the dialects. So languages become dialects for multilingual poetry.
Kamran, you had I see your hand raised up. So.
Thank you, Haris, and thanks, Iftikhar, for organizing this. It's been long, Haris. It's been a difficult year for all of us, and miss our times together and miss being with you and talking and hanging out. So I hope you've been well. Not because we are friends, I'm a great fan of your poetry. You know that. And perhaps later on, if there is time, you could share, because you write in English and in Urdu and Punjabi, but a translated poem or a original in English would also help us understand the flavor of your own idiom. So,
but with all due respect, Sylvia, Sara Shugufta did give a new voice to women, and I think it is important as these poets are also discussed, but. Sarwat Hussain has and Zeeshan Sahil were also in terms of Urdu. Sometimes Urdu poetry is actually criticized for being non-native in Pakistan. That is one criticism that some people, Urdu prose is not, because a lot of people from Punjab started writing in Urdu and they wrote about their own habitat. But in verse, even people from areas who spoke Urdu as their second language. They appropriated or acquired the same tradition, the same Persian tradition, Indo-Persian tradition, and started writing in that language. Iqbal is the biggest example. Faiz is another example. So these people, like Sarwat Hussain, Zeeshan Sahil, broke free from that tradition. And I think it is being progressive in itself, but it is more about the genre, the forms. Not in terms of themes, because their themes, they overlap. Their themes, some traditional poets were also writing on in traditional forms were also writing on the same themes. But something that really, makes them important is the nativity that they introduced. Zeeshan Sahil became a native Karachi poet. I mean, he was writing about that urban experience of a city bursting at its seams, where individuals, where human beings are reduced to being, cogs in, small cogs in the large wheel of capitalist, economy, and where environment is challenged, where climate. I mean, he actually speaks without calling himself and announcing himself as an environmentalist, but he is. I mean, if you look at his work, Sarwat Hussain introduced Sindhi idiom. Or Sindhi sensibility in Urdu poetry for the first time. So these people are very important. I'm glad that you raised it. I mean, but because of the paucity of time, I did not mention them, but I thank you for raising it. But awesome. You see, there is also a tradition. I'm sorry. I mean, I
and you Ray, you do the same with Punjabi.
And in I mean, in Punjabi, you would find in the Sri Ranju Bhatti, who is perhaps the contemporary of Kishwar Naid and Femi Daryaz, maybe a little younger. She died, earlier. But you know, the same sort of age cohort. The Sri Ranju Bhatti introduced such beautiful, writing, in prose poetry in both Punjabi and Urdu. So there are so many others. I mean, there are people who are writing after them. I mean, Nurul Huda Shah writes in Urdu. I mean, she writes both prose and poetry in Sindhi, but she writes poetry in Urdu also. Then there is Amar Sindhu in Sindh. There is Haseena Gul writing in Pashto. There are so many people who are writing, both prose poetry as well as traditional, using traditional forms.
Thank you.
Haris, can you tell us that how do poets, I mean, one question I have is how do people hear, I mean, how does poetry circulate in Pakistan, right? So in other words, that obviously there is the publications, people publish their verse, okay, which you've done. But apart from that, what other forums, exist that... that allow for poets to kind of, in a sense, bring their poetry to wider audiences?
You know, we still have, a tradition of literary journals coming out from all major towns, not just Karachi and Lahore. So we have a number of literary journals, periodicals that come out, and people publish their poetry in those journals. And of course, there's no space for poetry or regular poetry to be published in newspapers anymore. But these magazines provide a platform. But something, and of course, people come out with their books, but books are, anywhere in the world, I mean, books of poetry have a smaller print run, and it takes a long time, for poets to get established and get their books sold. Like Iftikhar Arif, for instance, came out with his collection last month. Our friend Huri Noorani published it, and within a month, even with an online launch and people not and under COVID restrictions, the whole edition, although it is not a very large number, but still the whole edition was sold within a month. So this also happens, but you have to be established to get there. Mm-hmm. And quite senior, really. But something that has revolutionized sharing of poetry is social media. And so you have some really, what I would say that time, temporary kind of and very low quality Instagram poets. But you also have some very serious, established, accomplished poets who have arrived sharing their verse through Facebook and Twitter and sharing, and particularly Facebook, because it has a sort of a bigger space. But you can create a link and share it on Twitter as well. So, and you find people, some of my contemporaries or people older than me, but certainly people younger than me who have created their pages on websites and platforms on internet. So this is one not very new anymore, but in the last 10 years, this has emerged. Facebook has emerged as one big platform where people can share their verse, and also, people have created their pages. Mm-hmm. Ebooks also are being, sold, but it'll take some time because Urdu, what we see happening in English is not happening with Urdu in Pakistan in terms of promotion of books and, English is the language of intellectual discourse. Unfortunately, it has become, I mean, there's nothing against English, but at the cost of our languages, English is considered the language of academia and intellectual discourse, or if not of academia entirely, but largely. And Urdu is the language of public discourse, and all our languages, including Urdu, are in languages in which we produce the best of our literature. So there is a bit of an issue of investment also.
Iftikhar, I mean, if others don't, I have one small
Yeah, please go ahead. I don't see any other question.
Okay. So come no, on, I just wanted to agree with Haris, and because of the thesis he's presenting around the sort of tense relationship with Urdu and sort of political sort of his political history of imposition of Urdu on a in a geography that has diverse cultures and languages and nationalities. But I think what you're saying, Haris, is so important, that the experimentation that people like yourself or Bhatti Saiba or others have done is where how Urdu will survive, by sort of this coming together of various kinds of linguistic idioms and registers. And I think that is what you're saying is so important to and to show that to our colleagues and students, and to really, this is how this language that has is an importation from a different part of South India, of South Asia. And, but its growth in this kind of multilingual and multicultural environment is to sort of Urdu's, that is sort of the challenge, the quote unquote progressive challenge. So a little bit of that. And Iftikhar, just with your permission, I know, Faiz Saab used to say every time when he would come for dinner, I suppose, and say, okay, Alice always says, did you sing for your supper? So, I mean, I don't want Haris to feel obliged, but yeah. I think for this audience, and Iftikhar, you're a dear friend, that's why I'm taking the liberty, although you're the chair of the event, yeah. But to not have Haris sing for this non-supper would be, I mean, at least we would get a sense of the really creative energies that you bring to the larger sort of literary world of Urdu, English, and Punjabi in South Asia and elsewhere. So that's
so. You know, would you want me to? I don't have any translation on me at the moment, but would you?
But you write in English as well, Nidost?
Yeah, so you want me to read an English poem, which is very different from the kind of work that I do in Urdu, but it will perhaps be more suitable. Yeah.
Perhaps you can do both, one Urdu and one English. Huh? Is that too much to ask?
No, it is not too much to ask, but how much time do you have?
we have another 15 minutes. So, 15 minutes.
Okay, then let me. Let me read you a poem. I mean, it's a little dark, but you know, I'm afraid. I mean, this is the kind of times that we live in, and the kind of. And there's no point in speaking to you, reading love poems. Some of you are much better at that. This poem is titled "Burying Martyrs." Burying Martyrs is the title. We turn into a funeral procession. All. We carry bodies on our shoulders. Martyrs, we are told. And martyrs are light. Light like rose petals. The ones we carry are heavy. They have metal inside. Bullets, shrapnel, pellets, nails. Tips of swords, daggers, broken in their flesh. The bodies will dissolve in the mud. Metal will keep the earth hard under our feet for long.
Wow.
And
Ashan.
There's another poem, in English, The Magician and the Boy, Waziristan. We know that there is Waziristan is under war for the last 30, 40 years. And this is a poem about a boy from Waziristan, The Magician and the Boy. Waziristan is in the northwestern part of Pakistan, which borders Afghanistan. And it has been a center of, the war that has been taking place in Afghanistan, the two wars. And it is a completely militarized zones, and people had to leave their homes, and they've suffered from a lot of violence, displacement, and deaths, and loss of livelihoods. The Magician and the Boy, Waziristan. Stony winter morning. Mist. Half awake, the magician answered the hurried knock at the front door. The boy, covered in dust, smell, carried a cumbrous sack on his back. Coarse jute threads interwoven, a flexible metal strip looped round the mouth of the sack. The boy looked straight into the magician's eyes. I come from far. I remember watching you in the circus with my father. You had cut a woman in half, put her back. They were all burned to death after the bomb went off. Only my mother's body is not charred. I bring her to you. She's only cut in half. I can actually, in from Urdu, I mean, these are, lately I've written long poems, but let me just read you.
There is someone is asking you to recite something that you wrote on rain when it happens and takes away the dust.
Okay. I'll have to.
It's in the chat. I don't know if you have it ready or not.
But this is, do you want me to read you a ghazal?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, because I've read two nazms in English, so to speak.
Haris also, I think, for the larger audience that may not know, just the form of a ghazal, if you could explain people. I mean, you have right. Already, yeah.
I have actually tried to. That ghazal is the most sort of straight jacketed form of expression, but the most popular, and it is rhythmic. It has a rhyme and a refrain, and each couplet is different from the next. Not necessarily, but mostly. So each two lines have a theme, and then the third and the fourth line will have different, and the fifth and the sixth. So it's just it is written like that. But there is sometimes a continuity of thought that you find in ghazal as well. But let me read something that is a little simpler, because I've been hugely influenced by Persianized expression in the last one year. Maybe it has to do with being grounded due to COVID and going back to your roots. But anyway, this is ye ghazal hai. Iske chand sher main aapko sunata hoon. Sher koi nahi kaha mansabo jaah ke liye. Sher koi nahi kaha मनसबो जाह के लिए नज्म कभी नहीं लिखी मीरे सिपाह के लिए.
वाह वाह.
शेर कोई नहीं कहा मनसबो जाह के लिए नज्म कभी नहीं लिखी मीरे सिपाह के लिए. लुक्मे तर अजीज तर था भी नहीं भी था के दर. लुक्मे तर अजीज तर था भी नहीं भी था के दर. खुलकर भी बंद ही रहा संजरो शाह के लिए. और हुस्न के सारे जाविये पेशे नजर रहे मगर.
हुस्न के सारे जाविये
पेशे नजर रहे मगर. दिल को लहू किया तो बस चश्मे स्याह के लिए. दिल को लहू किया तो बस चश्मे स्याह के लिए. और दर्द रहीन राज है दर्द से साजबाज है. दर्द रहीन राज है दर्द से साजबाज है. राहते जान रकीब है तेरे तबाह के लिए.
राहते जान रकीब है.
राहते जान रकीब है तेरे तबाह के और बोसे कुंजे लब ने कब कर दिया मुझको जां बलब, बोसे कुंजे लब ने कब कर दिया मुझको जां बलब, आरजुए हयात अब एक गुनाह के लिए, और हार से खाम से हजर कुफर भी कब है मोतबर, हार से खाम से हजर कुफर भी कब है मोतबर, तारिके दीनो दिल है एक गैरत माह के लिए, शेर कोई नहीं कहा मनसबो जाह के लिए, नज्म कभी नहीं लिखी मेरे सिपाह के लिए।
सुभानअल्लाह,
वेरी फाइन गज़ल, वेरी
फाइन। थैंक यू।
बट यू आर यूजिंग पर्शियनाइज्ड डिक्शन मच मोर देन यू नॉर्मली डू।
बट you see that happens, I mean sometimes, I mean there are, you see there are very few poets actually who can maintain the same what do you call the ahang, the rang, their specific way of writing. It's quite hard actually, and sometimes you also like to experiment, and you like to, people who are writing using modern expressions, sometimes they feel like going back to the classics and drawing upon the classics for their metaphors.
So this actually is very interesting discussion, because you are making me think of kind of emerging Urdu literature in new ways. Let me mention a conversation I had with a very important translator who actually translates from both Hindi and from Urdu, okay, and into English, and does very very high quality translations. And I was speaking to her at a conference, and she said, well, Hindi, English is, Urdu is like French, and I said, what do you mean Urdu is like French? She said, well, Urdu is, has guarded its, let's say, purity, okay? And it's both diction as well as vocabulary in ways that Hindi has not been able to do. In fact, the project for Hindi in India has been much more come to terms or come to reckoning with the diversity of the various linguistic registers that are spoken in India, right? And also, I was reading something recently by Tariq Rahman Saab, and he mentioned that how there is much more work that has been done on linguistics in India than has been done in Pakistan. So in other words, the impression I got from both of these is that Urdu has been, I mean, I think what you and your generation is doing is somewhat different. But until this generation, what Urdu was doing was to kind of, in a sense, guard its affiliation, its diction, and its kind of vocabulary and its mode of expression in ways that didn't change that much, Whereas the project of Hindi, because it's a kind of also a kind of a national project, right? In ways that Urdu, one would argue, is not in the same way in Pakistan. That Hindi tried to embrace all the kind of, let's say, the diversity that happens in Hindi was more than you would find in something like Urdu. That was the argument that she was making.
You see, a language should be like a zoo, not like a museum. You don't need to preserve it. You see, so we use, I literally use words from the languages, the Pakistani languages that I'm familiar with. And why not? I mean, that is the way, as Kamran had put it, that is the way for growth for all these languages. I mean, I would like to see Pakistan as a very vibrant, multilingual society. I mean, why do we have these unitary obsessions, there's no point. I mean, and it's a big country, and Urdu remains the lingua franca. I mean, it should be a people's language. It should not be imposed. And in order to become a people's language, and Kamran, it was not an importation really in that sense. In the cultural sense, it was not an importation, but in the political sense, it was. So I think that is something we need to look at. If you've got a couple of minutes, I would like to read you one small poem. I think it'll take a minute or. And it's in Urdu, and it is called Ishwar Kumar.
Ah, great. Okay.
It is about. I think you read it on Facebook when I posted it. Ishwar Kumar is a person who works in the chili market of chilies. There's a chili market in Kunri, and they are famous, the pepper, the red pepper market that we have in Kunri. And Kunri is a small town in the Thar desert near Mirpur Khas. And so it's a poem about this low caste or scheduled caste rather. We shouldn't call it low anyway, but you know, that's how they're defined, unfortunately. The scheduled caste.
Dalit may be a way of saying
Dalit. Dalit is the better word, but we don't use it in Pakistan as much as it is used in India, but you're right. A Dalit, a worker in that market, Ishwar Kumar, who goes to that market with his small 7-year-old son to work in that market. So it's a short poem about that. In Sindh, of course. Kundri mein surkh mirch ka bazaar aur haps. Kundri mein surkh mirch ka bazaar aur haps. Aankhon mein ret, galon par chatthe, syah hont. Kundri mein surkh mirch ka bazaar aur haps. Aankhon mein ret, galon pe chatthe, syah hont. हाथों की जिल्द खुरदुरी पोरें छिली हुई बेटा जो साथ का था उठा पाता कैसे बोझ वो तिनकों तीलियों में से मिर्चें टटोलता और बाप बोरियों में उन्हें भर के तोलता दिन ढल चुका बेटा जो साथ का था उठा पाता कैसे बोझ वो तिनकों तीलियों में से मिर्चें टटोलता और बाप बोरियों में उन्हें भर के तोलता दिन ढल चुका तो गांव की जानिब निकल पड़े हाथों में हाथ डाल के पैदल ही चल पड़े बेटा जो मां की गोद में गिरते ही सो गया तब ईश्वर कुमार ख्यालों में खो गया कच्ची शराब पीता रहा रात देर तक मुंह में भी आग भर गई मैदा भी जल गया कुछ होश जब उसे न रहा दिल संभल गया बहुत शुक्रिया थैंक यू वेरी मच
Thank you, Haris. Very beautiful poem. Thank you for being with us and sharing your both your ideas and your poetry. Thanks to the audience for coming, and I wish you all a good day. Okay. Take care.
Thank you.
Thank you, Haris.
Thank you.